HarperCollins and Harper Audio present American Negra, a Memoir by Natasha S. Alford. This is the author. To my parents, for your unconditional love. To the wanderers who cannot rest until they find home. Morenita, morenita, men have named you. Not Latina, morenita. Negrita chiquita de Estados Unidos. Tracy Morris, Morenita. Chapter 1. Pal Norte. I am a daughter of northern migrations, a love child of American dreaming, clashing with conquest and flight, sending two populations who should have been basking in the suns of southern states and the heat of Caribbean islands to a new, cold, snowy land they would call home, upstate New York. Most folks don't think of us people way up north, past the Big Apple that gets all the shine, but we are here. The peoples whose families boarded flights, ships, and invisible trains on the tracks of underground railroads just to make it to a land advertised as free. This is the land where I was born. If you ask Mommy, my birth was a miracle, not because of complications with the pregnancy or an inability to conceive, but because she originally wanted to be a nun. That's right, she had been a woman with a clear goal. The nunnery. Catholicism was in her blood as a Puerto Rican, and she attended Mass every Sunday thanks to the Spanish Empire's legacy of trying to convert the indigenous and African people on the island they colonized. However complicated the history, La Iglesia was tattooed on her soul. As a child, I cherished my mommy and daddy's love story like it was the stuff of romance novels. Knowing how different my parents were culturally and personality-wise, and what a miracle of chance their connection was, I was amazed their love could be so strong it transformed a woman who wanted to serve God for a living to cancel her plans and start a family. "We planned you," Mommy always insisted, almost defiant, a nod to my being born out of wedlock. Mommy was from the Bronx and had just finished her college degree at Cuca College in upstate New York before fate introduced her to Daddy. As a Puerto Rican, actually, let me be precise, a New Yorican, who'd grown up riding graffiti-covered subway cars, dancing to salsa at underground clubs with her twin brothers, taking trips to Coney Island with her little sister, and having picnics on the fire escape of the family apartment building, Mommy thought Syracuse, New York, the cold city she moved to after college graduation, was country. But she was only making a pit stop to escape her troubled home and see what life held for her. She met my father one night in 1984 when her roommate Olivia, another New Yorican transplant in Syracuse, invited her out to a nightclub called Grabbers. Grabbers was downtown. And as the club's soul music and latest 80s hits like Prince's When Doves Cry played, Mommy was accosted by a guy who saw their whole future before his eyes. "You and me could get married and I'll have your bathwater ready every night," he proposed as Mommy scanned the room meekly looking for an escape. Luckily, that's when Daddy saw her in distress and butted right into Mr. Bathwater's convo to introduce himself to her. Daddy was fresh out of the army with a short black afro and 6'1 military physique, the epitome of cool 70s soul. He had just traded driving around the hills and valleys of the world in his red and black Monte Carlo for his hometown of Syracuse to find work and take a break from back-to-back tours in Germany. Daddy grew up in a large Victorian-style home on Garfield Avenue, right next to the I-81. A highway that led to the demolishing of a historically African-American neighborhood called the 15th Ward to make way for urban renewal. His parents were only the second black family on their block when they moved in, but soon redlining real estate agents encouraged white families to sell their homes by stoking fears about how Negroes would ruin the neighborhood and lower property values. Daddy was patient with Mommy, an introvert who insisted on only friendship for an entire year, barely speaking as he chatted her up on the phone after her shifts at the care facility where she worked with disabled residents. One conversation at a time, he changed her mind about the nunnery. Mommy's father died when she was 9, and she had survived abuse at the hands of both of her drug-addicted stepfathers, each consecutively coming to her home like a wolf in sheep's clothing. Daddy had a troubled relationship with his father, which seemed to overshadow nearly every memory of his youth with a dark gray cloud of angst. My parents bonded over their childhood traumas, each of them with stories of pain that erased whatever cultural contrast they had and connected them on a human level. Neither of their families took offense at the intercultural symbolism of my parents' union. My father was a dark-skinned African-American man. My mother, a racially ambiguous, tan-skinned Puerto Rican, who was sometimes mistaken for a light-skinned African-American woman. It was a romantic pairing common in cities and hoods across America, where African-Americans and Puerto Ricans often lived side by side, and therefore fell in love, married, and brought children into the world. "We got Puerto Rican cousins anyways," was a frequent refrain from my Aunt Sin, referring to our cousins through marriage who had a Puerto Rican daddy. Aunt Sin loved Mommy to death and always wanted her to make empanadas to go during Thanksgiving. Meanwhile, Mommy loved my grandpa's pig's feet, only endearing her more to her future father-in-law, who had a complicated relationship with his eldest son. There may not have been a ton of Puerto Ricans on the south side of Syracuse, where Daddy grew up, but according to my Aunt Val, she saw right away that my mom was good for her headstrong brother and celebrated their love. On Mommy's side, the feeling was mutual. Her youngest sister, Titi Nina, had Black American friends. Her twin brothers, Uncle Tito and Uncle Jose, had done their share of ripping and running through New York City, dating and falling in love with women of every color and persuasion. "Oh, your mom bringing home a Black guy? Oh, we didn't care. I dated Black women too," Uncle Jose explained to me many years later, although admittedly he'd caught flack from some fellow Latinos who didn't like the crossing of cultural lines and called him a nigger lover. Mommy's family was so far removed from her daily life, with my abuela being down in Puerto Rico with my titi Nina and my uncles down in Florida, that meddling in their independent eldest daughter's romance wouldn't have made sense anyways. So they sent their bendiciones through the phone for the two lovebirds. My parents, who were only in their 20s when they had me in 1986, spent my early years doing the best they could to raise a child on their own, making use of the village they created upstate, but doing much of the heavy lifting themselves. My foundation of self comes from my parents, my mother with her big city upbringing yet shy demeanor, her affinity for pan, queso, and café for breakfast, her faith, and her compassion for children and the needy. And my dad with his inextinguishable confidence, a walking, talking Black history lesson of endless facts, despite having no college degree, with his posters of Malcolm X on our walls and his love of collard greens, yams, and chitlins. Different as they seemed, it turned out my parents had a lot more in common, more history and culture than was obvious at first blush. It all started with each of their family's courage to come up north. On Mommy's side, Abuela had flown to bustling New York City from Bayamón, a town near Puerto Rico's capital of San Juan. She came from a family of sugarcane plantation workers, carpenters, and working-class laborers. She'd been born in 1936, just 2 decades after Puerto Ricans had gotten U.S. citizenship through the 1917 Jones Act. The bill was introduced by 2 U.S. senators who thought extending citizenship to these island natives they'd inherited from Spain after the 1898 Spanish-American War would help with Americanization and pave a path for English-speaking Americans who wanted to do business on the island. While Puerto Ricans still couldn't vote in presidential elections, they could get on chartered planes to the U.S., come work for little pay in factories and farms while filling labor gaps for rich contractors. Abuela found work packing meat in a factory and secured an apartment in the Bronx, getting past landlords who discriminated against Puerto Ricans and mistook her for Jewish due to her ambiguous features and light skin. She had a small frame, but a vibrant voice, red dyed hair, and a prominent curved nose, her entire face the blueprint for my own. Abuela met Mommy's father, Abuelo Felix, way back in Puerto Rico. He was a charismatic, dark-haired country church boy, also from Bayamón, who also descended from sugarcane plantation workers and had a Black Puerto Rican father and a white Puerto Rican mother. Abuelo Felix and Abuela Sonia married in New York City and had Mommy in 1962, then her twin brothers 1 year later, Irish triplet style. Abuelo Felix was drawn to and eventually eaten up by the streets of New York, the vices of alcoholism and womanizing taking him away from the family, leaving Abuela and the kids to fend for themselves. My daddy's people came from the South. His mother, Florence, was from Mims, Florida, the daughter of a successful orange farmer named Fred Kyler. Orange farming ran in the family, and Fred was the son of Bentley Kyler Sr., another citrus grower who had actually gotten 40 acres, no mule, conveyed to him by his uncle. Bentley was so passionate about education, he gave land to Brevard County, Florida, to build a school for Black children called the Mims Colored School. Mary McLeod Bethune was his close friend, and right before great-great-grandpa Bentley died, she was there to witness him sign his will. Although Grandma's family was middle class, they were never fully treated as equals down in Florida. She had memories of the Ku Klux Klan riding through town and of cowering under her bed until they were gone. After having a baby in high school ended her educational journey, Grandma wanted work and a new life. So at the invitation of her uncle, she headed up north to Syracuse with her daughter, my beloved Aunt Cynthia. Grandma found a job at General Electric and met my grandfather. Grandpa grew up in Pinehurst, North Carolina, by way of South Carolina. A boy with many sisters and brothers, he was rumored to have had a Cherokee grandmama. At a young age, he had to drop out of school to work in farming and help his family. He was the descendant of an enslaved Black man named Beachman Alford, who toiled on the M.B. Gandy Plantation in Darlington, South Carolina. Beachman had lived to see Black folks go from slavery to emancipation, and his name was found on the contract for the Freedmen's Bureau, where he signed with an X, promising to continue sharecropping the land of his former masters, to take care of their tools, and of course to keep no weapon or gun on him should he get any grand ideas as a newly freed Black man. With the blood of survivors running through his veins, Grandpa made his way up to Syracuse from North Carolina, eventually getting a good-paying job at the Crucible Steel Factory and starting his family with Grandma. They had four children together, my daddy, his brother Leonard, my aunt Valerie, and their baby brother Aaron. Syracuse was Daddy's hometown, and it became mine when I was born. From the time I was a child, I remember the snow, falling like cold white stars from the sky, blanketing hills, streets, and homes like cozy sleeping bags, and piling high on the street corners into mountains we'd dash up to avoid brown, slushy pools beneath our feet. It was a place of marvelously colored autumns and idyllic summers, welcomed with joy as Syracusans celebrated freedom from their frosty prison. It was a humble town, the Northern Rust Belt, a city where people knew hard work, clocking into factories like the Chrysler car plant and Carrier air conditioning plant, where mom-and-pop shops could thrive, where families stayed close and for generations. We took pride in not being New York City, taking umbrage when confused for being downstaters. Despite Syracuse's origins as a booming town known for producing salt, once factories started closing en masse, shipping operations overseas, it drove a dagger through the heart of the local economy. There was poverty, deep, entrenched, and so harsh, there were poor white folks down bad in the struggle. Still, there was no question that a quiet line of segregation kept many Black folks and other people of color.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.